like vestry, church wardens, of this cathedral church dedicated to St. McCartan, I would like to welcome you all to the service of Choral Evensong in thanksgiving for the life and work of the Blessed John Sullivan, who, as a schoolboy, sat in these pews almost 150 years ago when he was a boarder at Portora Royal School. We are delighted that Archbishop Michael and Archbishop Dermot are with us today as we reflect on the formation of his faith as a schoolboy who loved to spend time on the nearby Devonish Islands and his life of prayer and service to others as a priest in Clongowes. We remember particularly the provincial Leonard because he's been bereaved by a member of the family, and we have in place a former provincial, Father Tom Clayton. He's very welcome here to the service this afternoon. We are humbled that so many of you have travelled from across the island of Ireland and are grateful to the Sullivan family who have come over from England to be with us today. You are very welcome. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, and to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the sin by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times to humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet we ought most chiefly so to do, when we assemble and meet together, thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, and set forth his most holy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of thy heavenly grace.
Mighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness to live, and have given power and command unto his ministers, declare and pronounce for his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent, and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do in this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Oh, chapter of the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, son of your uncle Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanamel came to me in the court of the guard, in accordance with the word of the Lord, and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field at Anathoth for my cousin Hanamel, and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase, containing the terms and conditions, and the open copy, and I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Maaseiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence I charged Baruch, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar, in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses, and fields, and vineyards,
do not use your freedom as a pretext for evil. Honor everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the Emperor. Here endeth the second lesson.
Thank you.
which we heard as our second lesson. 1 Peter chapter 2 and the 17th verse. Give due honor to everyone. Love your fellow Christians. Reverence God. Honor the emperor. Letters ascribed to St. Peter open our eyes to a Christianity that has clearly expanded well beyond the geographical boundaries of Israel and Palestine. Not only is this the case geographically, but also politically, and therefore in terms of belonging. The Christians to whom these letters are written are woven into the tapestry of an empire where living and working for Jews alongside Gentiles is now a norm for those who derive their new religious identity from Jesus of Nazareth, that extraordinary individual whose life and death continue to inspire people to live and to die. This same situation remains in some tangible form until this very day. We are living inheritors, therefore, of this working relationship, a relationship that is sometimes easy, sometimes uneasy, and sometimes downright impossible, between faith and policy, between love and hatred, between heaven and earth. And for us here in all parts of this island, it is made relatively simple by the fact that we have an easy and a ready freedom to worship. It had become a norm midway through the first century for Christians to be used as scapegoats in persecution from time to time in the Roman Empire of the day. The backdrop of the letters of Peter is Nero's Rome. The author is fueled by the desire to offer an encouragement to Christians across the empire to hold on and to hang in. We might have expected his advice to have been to pull away and to go underground instead. But no, his advice is practical and unspectacular, but at the same time, courageous and useful. We still have it. We still go back to it as a reference point and as a yardstick. He offers a formula for survival that is familiar and well known to us. Give due honor to everyone. Love your fellow Christians. Reverence God, honor the emperor. The first two words, of course, are the motto of Portora Royal School, and we know them in their Latin form, omnes honorate, honor everyone. It is hardly surprising that these two words should be used as the motto of a plantation school in Ulster, founded in the early 17th century, in order to develop and to educate a steady stream of local pupils to facilitate the smooth administration and the local government of County Fermanagh. As Ireland developed and as Portora expanded, both its intake of pupils and its remit of influence, the origin of the school was never forgotten, nor was it suppressed. To have done so would have been to betray and to subvert the motto itself, as it would have been to dishonor it. And the recognition and the acceptance of such history has not impeded the evolving and the enriching contributions that Portora has made to history itself. History local and universal throughout the centuries. This proved to be invaluable during the days that cannot be forgotten, because what was done cannot be unknown. That is, during the days of the Troubles. During this sustained period of recent history, while emotions ran high, and while the local character of community life, relationships, and neighborliness in the fullness of time came home to help more than it did to hinder, this invitation to give honor to everyone was fiercely tested, yet sustained, in and out of school. The capacity of Enniskillen and of County Fermanagh generally to live through the Troubles and to live through the iconic and tragic events of the Enniskillen bomb and their devastating aftermath bears witness to the wider applicability of such a model to a range of situations and right across this county. Honour counters horror. Violence is not victorious. God is not mocked. The Portora of John Sullivan was in many ways familiar family territory. His father was a Portoran, as was his brother. Classics were in his day, so to speak, the chemistry of our day. With a classical education, you could do virtually anything. You could undertake most careers. John Sullivan went from Portora to read classics in Trinity College Dublin and then to read for the bar. His father was the Lord Chief Justice of Ireland, and there were all the signs that John Sullivan has the skills and the talents to be successful in this area of life. His life took a different turn and has given us the glorious and unique opportunity to be here and to be here together today. He moved from high end to humility, from profile to pastoral concerns, from self to God and God's people. We come to a church that would have been known to John Sullivan as somewhere to which the school would come for Sunday services. Its worship is something to which he never really refers, yet his knowledge of both the Church of Ireland and the Roman Catholic traditions stood to him and stand to us today through the example of lived holiness in the everyday things of life for which he has become renowned. It is this combination of what once seemed impossible and that now seems in so many parts of the world to be natural, humane and organic, by which I mean friendships across fractured traditions, respect across embedded sectarianisms. It is this that makes both the Portoran family, as the Portoran presence at the service of beatification in the Jesuit church in Gardiner Street in Dublin showed, and the Jesuit family, as their presence here today shows, equally grateful for John Sullivan. His openness to what we call the two traditions is something that is of the spirit of the two schools, with which he will ever be associated. Portora Royal School and Clonfos Wood College. Aeterna non caduca, eternal not falling, is the Clonfos motto. It too points us to a noble ideal and a positive aspiration for self-understanding and for service of others. It is very important for us all to keep our eyes on higher ideals and not to let our expectations falter and fall. The honouring of others marches with the raising of aspirations to create engaged citizenship and to advance the public good. We live in a world where love no longer is a public good. We must look to principled youth. being here this afternoon stands firm in a context of tolerance and inclusion that have flourished as a response to dark and difficult times in Enniskillen. The annual visit of the boys from Clongowes with their teachers to Enniskillen around the time of Remembrance Sunday is memorable and much appreciated to this day. Always, in respectful youth, they have been laying a wreath at the war memorial, which had been the scene of what will ever be known as the Enniskillen bomb, detonated in 1987. Their presence and contribution were always eagerly awaited. In a situation of sadness and devastation, in a place of near hopelessness and clouded tragedy, it often can take other things from the outside to unlock the misery. For the young people of Enniskillen, the annual visit of members of Clongowes Wood College did just that. Meetings and seminars were arranged with community and civic authorities locally. They might simply not have been possible were the visitors not the catalyst of change and of comprehension, of open questioning and of optimism. Questions could be asked together that would not have had the same energy as they would have were they asked separately. Nor might people have had the nerve to do so at all. All of this has been a tremendous boost to the rebuilding, and indeed the building anew, of community confidence and community expression, not least in the arts in Enniskillen. For all of this, Enniskillen and its generations of young people remain grateful to the school where John Sullivan lived for the greater part of the second half of his life, Clongowes Wood College. The other thing that Clongowes has given us in Enniskillen is the Joyce Beckett Literary Link and the Joyce Beckett Literary Award. Again, this is a piece of creative lateral thinking, a piece of living in the world of the imagination and of literary greatness, while continuing to go to school and to do all of the things that make up the jigsaw of school that we find tedious, if not very tedious. And this brings me to the prophetic instinct of Jeremiah, as voiced in the first lesson. Jeremiah buys a field. He buys a field as a pledge of both the present and the future. There is, argues Jeremiah, more hope that the future will happen if the present happens, and if his people and God's people look upwards rather than looking downwards. This is the message of hope and of adventure in the heart of adversity and alienation. It also deftly combines the mottos of both of today's schools. Old Testament prophecy has a message for today as well as for yesterday. It speaks of adventure and of justice. It speaks of restoration and of the underdog. It speaks of the forgotten and of the obscene, and names them all in the name of God. Everything will happen in some shape or form, like it or like it not. The context changes. The message needs to be dusted down and read against our current situation. This is what tradition does. This is who tradition is. And this brings me to the ways in which history changes under our feet and indeed around our ears. Ireland of the founders of both of these schools was quite different from any of the manifestations of Ireland that have followed them. We are part of a moving history. history moves, whether we ourselves move with it or not. Young people show us this on a daily basis. Portora has changed and continues to work at implementing and living that change. I have no doubt that Clongowes changes regularly and radically all the time too. Both schools can look forward through the lens of their school motto, individually and together. Honour everyone. What is eternal, not what is falling. Because both point to the positive as the key of interpretation of a history that surrounds us and is always in danger of engulfing us if we sit and watch it. Person of John Sullivan continues to draw affection and devotion, respect and admiration to countless people. His kindness and his carefulness marched hand in hand with erudition and simplicity. In the sermon most recently preached at the John Sullivan commemoration in Gardiner Street in February of this year, Archbishop Martin spoke of the people who crowded around Jesus for healing. He went on to speak of the way in which their need and their urgency brought out the best in the exhausted Jesus. Sometimes we tend to forget that Jesus was also human and could be utterly exhausted. And sometimes the church steers us in this direction. And sometimes we can miss out on what in fact was really going on. Sometimes we just slip or slide over the givingness, the generosity of Jesus, who gave without counting the cost. The abiding charism of John Sullivan was with the sick and in the ministry of healing. He is renowned for this among the people of Kildare, local to Clongowes, and in the hospitals of Dublin, where he visited tirelessly among the sick. Healing is a word of many meanings. Healing is a word of many faces. Healing is the most urgent need in contemporary Ireland. Hurting and healing march together, as Seamus Heaney used that word, march. We live in a world of sophisticated and advanced individualism. This is the world we have created, and this is the world we wanted, and this is the world with which we now have to deal. There is no point in blaming others for it. At the same time, a wide range of good people and different people weave their convictions and their commitments into a practical generosity and an objective fairness that tests the assumptions of state and of church. Both of these institutions are tested daily. Many on the inside of both are not accustomed to this, nor are they really prepared for it. But these same good and different people seek to serve the community beyond the church and beyond politics. Many of them genuinely find little of interest in either. They in fact think that both institutions have had their fair chance, have had now a fair crack of the whip. Recently, I was in the Diocese of Jerusalem with one of the clergy in Dublin and Glendalough as part of our diocesan link. You see, I did learn some things in Glover, which was to make a link with the Diocese of Jerusalem. When asked a direct question about his chaplaincy work among young people, my friend instinctively replied as follows. Irish young people are passionate about justice. Irish young people are passionate about justice. It is such a passion for justice that without institutions so greatly need. It is to young people that we who find ourselves inside those institutions ought to be looking, as well as looking to those of mature and radical experience. We need a blended economy of commitment and of vision to build a just society. In all humility, we need to start all over again, with comprehension and compassion, meeting realism and response. These deliberate actions will bring us back to words and activities of which we have long ago tired. That is, words like compromise and reconciliation, but words which we have to relearn. That is, if we ever want to try, north, south, east and west, to do what a predecessor of mine referred to in the following terms: learning to agree, to disagree agreeably. Learning to agree, to disagree agreeably. It is the last word, of course, agreeably, that regularly and historically eludes us. Jeremiah chapter 32 and the 8th and 9th verses. I recognized that this instruction came from the Lord. So I bought the field at Anatoth from my cousin Hanamel and weighed out the price for him, 17 shekels of silver.
Thank you. of thy favour, and glad to do thy will. Bless our land from north to south and east and west with honourable industry, sound learning and pure manners. Save us from violence, discord and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil way. Endue the spirit of wisdom those to whom in thy name we entrust the authority of governments for both north and south, the Queen and the President, that there may be justice and peace at home, and that through obedience to thy law, we may show forth thy praise among the nations of the earth. In the time of prosperity, fill our hearts with thankfulness, and in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in thee to fail. All which we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord.
And a prayer for all schools, colleges, and places of learning throughout the land. O eternal God, bless all schools, colleges, and universities, and especially both the schools associated with the Blessed John Sullivan, represented here today. Clongowes Wood College, and the newly formed Enniskillen Royal Grammar School. We pray for the rector, headmaster, staff and young men of Clongowes Wood, who stood alongside the people of Enniskillen during difficult times, and for the principal, staff and pupils of Enniskillen Royal as they build on the ethos and rich legacy of Portora Royal School and Enniskillen Collegiate School. That both schools may be lively centres for sound learning, new discovery and the pursuit of wisdom. And grant that those who teach and those who learn therein may find in you the source of all truth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
We give thanks to you for the faith of the Church handed down to us through the Apostles and Saints, especially in this land through Patrick and in this diocese through MacArthur. Today we especially give thanks for the life, work and witness of John Sullivan, for his life of deep spiritual reflection and personal sacrifice, for his dedicated work with the poor and afflicted. Almighty God, who has knit together thine elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of thy Son, Christ our Lord, grant us grace so to follow thy blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those unspeakable joys which thou hast prepared for them, unfeignedly love thee, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
A prayer for clergy and people. O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. More especially we pray for the good estate of the Catholic Church, for that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate, especially those for whom our prayers are desired, that it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings, and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ, his sake. Amen.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, thy unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but for all thy death, O God, in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. We beseech thee to give us that true sense of all thy mercies, and our hearts may be unfailingly thankful, and show the glory of thy grace, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord, to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen.
Oh, this is a unique occasion. A unique occasion which, reflecting together, thanking God for the gift of that extraordinary man, John Sullivan, that we come together to traditions, to schools, a community, all of us coming together to find something of the depths of our own belief in Jesus Christ. I thank the Dean, and I thank Bishop John for inviting me. I thank this congregation for welcoming me. I'm talking about the congregation of this cathedral church, but also clearly of an ecumenical congregation of friends in Jesus Christ, which means so much to the makeup and build-up of this city. John Sullivan was, his spirituality was the root of two traditions. He didn't become holy when he became a Catholic. He didn't become holy when he became a Jesuit. It may have helped. But his roots go back to his early childhood, to his days in Portora, where he had developed a great reflection on the scriptures which accompanied him all through his life. So he's a fruit of two traditions, but there's also a sense that the way he lived and the way he renounced what is superficial enabled him to rise even above those traditions and to enrich those traditions, bring something different and something new into the way he lived and into the society to which he belonged. He was known as the best dressed man in Dublin. In those days, men did dress well. Perhaps today, it wouldn't be quite the same. But then you find this man who changed. When he moved back to Dublin from his life in London, he stripped his residence of anything that was superficial. And he's remembered seen going out, particularly to the sick, and to the sick poor, and to the sick poor in their own homes. He had this extraordinary care for the sick. And when you try to ask what that means, one of the things he had was he had time for the sick. He spent time with them. He listened to them. He prayed with them. He helped them to face the difficulty of facing the big challenges of life and death in their own lives. Today, we don't have time to do that. At times, by the hustle and bustle, not of the complexity of the way we look after the sick. We can pride ourselves on advances in technology, but I don't think either any of us, either north or south, can really pride ourselves on our healthcare system for all, especially the poor, and especially for the elderly. I remember when my own father was dying, speaking to the matron of the hospital where he was, and about some of the difficulties that they had to face. And she said to me, "Father," she said, "modern medicine is a terrible thing." She said, "You can't light a blessed candle beside a dying man, or you'll blow up the whole hospital." We need both. The developments in modern medicine are vital, but if it isn't accompanied by humanity, and particularly humanity for those who are poorest and most alone. I often think it must be terribly lonely to be dying surrounded just by machinery, as you stay there and you're facing such an amazing thing. But John Sullivan was a man who was able to do that. And Pope Francis issued a document this week on holiness, pointing out that holiness is the call of all Christians. Every Christian is called to be holy. And most Irish people, certainly Irish men, wouldn't go around telling people, "I'm holy." It's not in our tradition. And indeed, I suppose it is in our tradition to be very suspicious of anybody who did say to you, "I'm holy." But there's something about holiness which we have to learn. It's an essential dimension of being a Christian. And John Sullivan was a model of holiness for us. One of the points that the Pope stressed very much is that holiness isn't simply about formulas of doctrine or of particular practices, but the holy person must be a person who reflects the care of Jesus. The care of Jesus for the sick, the troubled, for those weighed down by heavy burdens. And that again is part of the call that we have to learn from this man. In the Catholic tradition, what is a blessed or a saint? It's not just these are people who are wonderful examples of life. It's not, you couldn't write a novel and say this is about a holy man or a holy woman. Holiness is about a concrete people. And the church recognizes in a man like Dr. John Sullivan, not just a historical figure. Our cathedrals are covered with stones and memories of people. That isn't what a saint is. A saint is somebody who came so close to God that we can turn to them, and that in some way or other they can help God's grace to arrive at us. If you saw the cross that John Sullivan had, and the extraordinary devotion there is to people who are dying or sick, or the relatives also are dying or sick, because they know that in some way or other, this man, his life of grace, his goodness, his life of holiness, it can act in some way or other, some mysterious way, as someone who intercedes for us. And we pray that all of us, that intercession of John Sullivan will help us to be holy, to rise above the narrowness of our lives, and that he will again serve as a way in which we can commit ourselves to work for a more just and a more caring world. Amen.
Just before the blessing, if I could add my thanks to all who have been here today, who have travelled from very far to be here, for all who have taken part in the service, for very wise and witty and witty words from our preachers, for the family, for suggesting the service to us in the first place, for the dean for taking that up, for so many from the Society of Jesus who have travelled, and I think one passionist as well, who is also recognised. And for all from this community who have come to support this service, John Sullivan as a sign of unity between our two communities and our two traditions. So God, who in days of old gave to this land the benediction of his holy church, filled you with his grace, faithfully follow in the steps of the saints, and bring forth fruit to his glory. Blessing of God Almighty, the Father.